we'd like to welcome in our service today.
Good morning.
Well, we made it clear back from the Kansas City area.
Yes.
Had to see old friends and family. And no snow, but a slight dusting is all. So I know you were praying for me clear across the country. Well, 2024, to say that time goes by quickly is so true, because the other day it reminded me of the Y2K thing. That's been 24 years ago. Unbelievable. So. But we, so a new year, optimism, and I'm glad you're here today. We have board meeting on Wednesday, 6:30, January 10th. Yes, what is going on? Were there any other announcements?
Yes.
You got your list there?
I'll just do it from here.
All right.
We have a luncheon next door. Please, even if you didn't bring anything, come over and eat. There's a lot of soup over there. So please come over. The envelopes are on the back table. If you see your name there, grab your envelopes. It's much easier for the treasurer to give your put your contribution into the computer if you put your money in an envelope. Also, the spaghetti dinner tickets are still available. I will not be here next week, but if you need to purchase them next week, Ruthie will be in charge, so you see Ruthie.
Ruthie, hit me for 15 when we're done here today.
15.
Okay. Well, I'm glad you're here today to start a new year, and let's begin with the word. Am I on the air yet or what?
Yes, you are.
And this is recorded too.
I can't wait to see that.
The editing department will take care of that.
You, Pastor, you know who will call me? Pat Duncan, and she'll say, "What happened?"
Yeah. Okay, well, let's begin with a word of prayer. Lord Jesus, we come before you. The world we live in last year was a crazy place. A lot of crazy things going on. We started the year with optimism, but whatever happens around it in the world and our country, it doesn't affect our personal relationship with Jesus Christ. For when Jesus is your Savior, we don't have to worry. We don't know the future, but thank God we know the one who knows the future, and that is Jesus Christ, our Lord. I pray your Spirit will move among us, and with our choir, myself, and we proclaim the message. It's not about us, it's about lifting up Jesus. In his name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
Of salvation through the gospel.
O come, let us worship the Lord, for God has done wondrous things.
And God indeed has done wondrous things. Our next is We Three Kings, number 254.
Oh.
Lord in prayer. Keep Tom in prayer. His sister Linda LaRue, he's 78, that passed away. And Tom, rest assured you have been in my prayers.
Thank you.
Okay. Also, keep my son Matt in prayer. He needs some prayer right now, situation he's going through. So I would appreciate prayer for him too. Carla's sister, Eileen Kendall, she had surgery, had a tumor removed the size of a golf ball. So that's pretty big. I had a tennis ball taken out of me up there. But she's got other issues beside that. So please keep the family in prayer also. Okay. Any other joys, concerns that she would like to share? Yes.
Our son, Carl, who the church has been praying for, this past week had a seizure. So he was back in the hospital for a day. And
right.
They've given him new medication
okay.
to help with the seizures.
Right.
So I did talk to him yesterday.
Okay.
He's done it much, much better. So
right.
Thank you for the prayers. Thank you for the concerns. Thank you so much for the phone call. That was wonderful. Okay. Thank you. So that's where we are.
I know as a parent, we kind of wish, give me the sickness and make them well, but it doesn't work that way. No, but we've seen a lot of miracles in this church and soon to be finished, soon to start 14 years here. And no doubt God does answer prayer, he truly does. Okay, anyone else? Yes.
I want to thank everybody for their prayers for my son, David. His leg is feeling a lot better.
Yeah.
But the drop foot is still there, and now they just have to work on that and see what they can do.
Okay.
And also keep him in your prayers. He got laid off from his job. The project, he was a construction manager, and the project that he was on has ended, and so there comes the layoff. So he's out searching for new employment. So keep him in his prayers that something will come up.
Okay, sure will. Okay.
And praise for our visitors too.
It's good to have visitors here. Now having the
got a request.
Good of you have a request.
Yeah, just pray for salvation of our family members that don't know the Lord.
Yeah. Boy, that's you know, sometimes I found over the years your family members are the toughest to try to share the Lord with somehow at this
mm-hmm.
stuff. But never give up on that. I mentioned this before in church, when we lived in Ohio, Panicstone, Bradford. And there was a fellow there, and his wife prayed almost 10 years, and he would drop her off at the church, and then he would attend once in a while. But and then finally, she felt the Lord was going to, this was going to be the year. And the evangelist's name was Nelson Perdue, and he gave an invitation to come to the altar rail, and he didn't budge. And then finally, they're getting ready to leave, and they couldn't find him. And he was there leaning over the altar rail with tears in his eyes. And they came up and prayed with him, and he said, I've fought this for so long, but I can truly say from this service, I can say Jesus Christ is my personal Savior, and for the first time in my life, I know if I die, I'll be in heaven. So don't ever give up. We've seen in 45 years of ministry, I've seen some pretty tough people. Another one down was in Ohio, there was a fellow that I went to visit because I knew his children, his daughter. And not too often people told me to go to H-E-L-L in a hospital room. He was the nastiest man I ever met. I won't mention his name, but I'll never forget it. And I was persistent. And then I went there and they started walking. They said, well, aren't you going to pray for me again? And I said, well, last time you told me to go to a place I don't want to go to, a place I preach against. And he said, well, I was out of line. I said, well, we're agreeing on something, but you were out of line. And so I had a prayer with him and everything, and I just said, Lord, just soften his heart. Lord, come into his heart. And I got a call from his daughter. He said, I talked to Dad, and he said, he had a preacher come by, and we prayed, and he was right, I've been wrong, and so now I know Jesus. He died a couple weeks later. His daughter had prayed that if Dad was really saved, I would do the funeral. But he's a member of another church in town, and that this wasn't going to happen. And so that's what they were going to have. She said, I can't believe God let me down. I said, well, who does the funeral is not important. I'll ask them to say a few words. We're getting ready to go to Louisville, Kentucky to see relatives. And they came up the street honking the horn, waving their hands. And she said, Dad, Reverend Williamson is going to be calling you. He had an emergency in his family. He'll be out of town, and he thought you should be the one who did the service, since you were, and it all worked out. And that was the first funeral I ever did, but I can just say to you, don't ever give up. I remember a minister said one time, keep praying. I hate to stop praying, be a prayer away from God answering, but I know for a fact that that man, as mean as he was, God has a way of touching the heart of even the meanest person. And I was no prize when I wasn't a Christian either. I done a lot of things I wouldn't want people to talk about, but it does make a difference. And I'm thankful that at the age of 22, I accepted Christ. So again, I'll keep you in prayer. Don't give up, because it is his, scripture says it's his will that none should perish, but that all should come to repentance. And I love the word all, because it's all inclusive. I don't believe in a limited atonement where some people are meant to be in hell, some are being in heaven. I don't believe that nonsense. I believe that Christ came to earth to die on the cross, and through his death, we have eternal life. And all you have to do is accept Christ as your Lord and Savior. So praise God, and the Lord's gonna work. We don't say, I just want to tell people I'll be saved. I've saved zero people. Yeah. I've never saved a person in my life. I don't have the ability to. But I have had the ability to share the gospel. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And God used me, but it's the Holy Spirit that deals with people. Okay. All right.
We have to remember too the vision of the crucifixion with Christ hanging there on the cross. And one of the, I don't want to call him a gentleman, but a man that was being crucified along with Jesus, in his last breath, he turned his head to Jesus and repented for his sins, right, and told the Lord that he wanted to be forgiven. Right. And what did the Lord do? He said, today you
shall be in paradise.
So it can be the very last breath that you take. You never stop working on somebody.
Right.
You know somebody that is almost willing to give themselves to the Lord.
Right.
Don't ever stop working on.
Exactly.
Don't ever stop working on.
For sure. Okay. Anyone else? Come
here. I want to say a prayer for my friend Dee, who's come here for different functions. She went in for sinus surgery, went into AFib. They took her from the surgical center to the emergency room, and then they were going to admit her. But she got to wear a Holter monitor for her heart, and she's going on a blood thinner.
Okay.
She also has something called cardiomyopathy, some form of cardiomyopathy, which is what Billy dies of.
Right.
So luckily she's being treated for that, but that might have a play in why she went into AFib. We don't know. But the hospital was gonna send her home, and her cardiologist she followed up with said, looked at all her charts and said, I'm not happy that they sent you home, they should have kept you.
Yeah.
But the hospital was packed.
Yeah.
So
probably
one of the reasons why
they
sent
her home. She's
wearing her mask.
My daughter has opened up her business at another location,
right,
in Hamilton.
Right.
And I remember about 15 years ago when she first opened up her first business, she did it because the Lord, she felt, was opening the door for her,
right,
to,
right,
do the business.
Right.
Now, went over yesterday to see her new shop, and we sat and prayed that the Lord would be there in his,
right,
presence for,
right,
her. So I asked for her to keep,
okay,
God in her life.
Right.
You know, that she's doing.
Well, the Lord directs her in good shape.
Oh, yes.
That's for sure, yeah. Yeah. Okay, anyone else?
Well, yes. Jean Long said hello to everybody and Happy New Year. And my neighbor Ruth, she fell on December 20th and broke her hip. And it's really a shame. But anyway, she's going to now go to rehab for a little bit. She's getting around. And she called me yesterday and we were talking. And she said, thank you for all the prayers. And I said, well, I will let everybody know now. Her name is Ruth, that she is recovering and she's doing well. And she's very, very active.
Right.
So this is killing her being housebound for a while. And my son went to urgent care this morning. It is definitely a pulled muscle, so he's going to get some medication for that. And then my daughter-in-law called me, and Brooklyn's going to urgent care, ear, nose, and throat. So it's probably just a cold or whatever, but just make sure Everybody should wear in open spaces with a lot of people. It's mandatory in a lot of places now to wear a mask. So just preventative, that's all. And happy new year, everybody.
All that good news.
Yeah.
Yes.
My sister Anna, she's 82. She was taken to the hospital yesterday by her son. She has vascular dementia. Her vital signs are good. She's recovering fine.
Right. And that's Anna?
Anna.
Okay, let me put that down. Okay.
Last name Vogel, V-O-G-E-L.
Vogel? I got her pen here. Okay, anyone else? Dottie, is it?
No.
Okay. Okay, let's come to the Lord in prayer. Lord, we pause now to come to you in prayer. Some of these situations are rather difficult to share this morning, along with those on our prayer list. But Scripture says, with things with God, all things are possible. We do claim that promise. We've got to let go of the reins of our life and let Jesus take hold of us, and it can make all the difference. So many times we try to solve it ourselves. We call friends and ask, what should we do? But God, right there at the moment, is there ready to hear and answer prayer. And we put our faith and trust. Lord, our past year has been kind of a difficult year. With great anticipation, look to the new year ahead of us. It's been the first Sunday of the year. But I pray, Lord, that as a church, we would put our full faith in you. Not question God. Sometimes we pray for something we shouldn't pray for, or a direction we don't need to do. But we need to just let go and let God. So Lord, meet the needs that are here today. Perhaps some have unspoken requests, they're not comfortable in sharing them. But Lord, that's okay, because you know the very inner feelings of our heart. So Lord, meet our needs, and may we see the value and importance of prayer as we pray the prayer you taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. At this time, when the ushers come forward to receive our morning offering. Now bless this offering that we may share the message of Christ, in whose name we pray.
Amen.
You may be seated. Chapter 2, I'm going to read the first 12 verses. A very familiar topic on this occasion. We read these from Gospel Matthew. After Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea, during the time of King Herod, Magi from the east came to Jerusalem and asked, "Where is the one who has been born King of the Jews? We saw his star when it rose and have come to worship him." When King Herod heard this, he was disturbed, and all Jerusalem with him. When he had called together all the people's chief priests and teachers of the law, he asked them where the Messiah was to be born. "In Bethlehem of Judea," they replied, "for this is what the prophet has written. But you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah. For out of you will come a ruler who will shepherd my people Israel." Then Herod called the Magi secretly and found out from them the exact time the star had appeared. He sent them to Bethlehem and said, "Go and search carefully for the child. As soon as you find him, report to me, so that I too may go and worship him. After they had heard the king, they went on their way, and the star they had seen when it rose went ahead of them, until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they were overjoyed, and coming to the house, they saw the child his mother Mary. They bowed down and worshipped him. Then they opened their treasures, presented to him the gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And having been warned in a dream not to go back to Herod, they returned to their country by another route. Let us pray. Lord, I pray that you'll use this message you've asked me to prepare, but nothing happens until the Spirit works. And so, Lord, I'm your servant. Don't bring attention to me this morning. Let us lift up Jesus, in whose name we pray.
Amen.
Amen. So a lot of stories about the characters here, and obviously the wise men of that camp do not really belong in that scene. But I'd asked one time, why did they put them in there? And their crazy response was, we can double the price of the nativity set by making more figures. And I said, I'm not thinking that's funny at all. But the fact is, we have to display them somewhere. But actually, it was 2 years later. A lot of people don't realize that. These men were determined. Talk about determination. For 2 years, following a star. Now, I've always told you some of my oddball moments when you're put on the spot. Someone said, what's the most time you're put on the spot? I have to say, when I did my doctoral degree and had to defend my thesis, that was truly intimidating. I'm so glad it was over. But right behind that would be when I had to talk to teenagers in the youth group of the church. The questions they will ask. I can remember some of them and I'll never forget. What happened when it was overcast? What did they do at that time? What did they do all the time during the day? They were traveling, they couldn't get a job. How did they survive? I can't answer those questions. But I think they got together and tried to stump the preacher and the youth director. And they were pretty good about that. There's a lot of things we don't really know about them. But we do know one thing I want to focus on this morning is these three gifts. And to me, they're encouraging, and as you'll see when we get to that part. And Jesus is no longer a tiny baby, 2 years of age. Now they're living in a house. Scripture tells us that. This sort of takes away the image of the nativity scene, but we want to stay true to the text. There are a lot of legends about these wise men that traveled. And somebody even said, was there really three of them? There were three gifts. It doesn't say three men. But in the early days of Eastern tradition, there were 12 wise men that came to the home of Jesus. Way back in, you hear these other things people believe. But now the tradition has narrowed it down to three, almost now universal belief in those who believe this. New Testament does not say there were three, but it derived from the fact of the three presents. Later legend makes them kings. And still legend gave them names, Caspar, Melchior and Belshazzar, and you know I have a hard time pronouncing names. Later legends sign them a personal description. We hear more about them, but they say most of it, if you Google it, is legend, to say the least. And it says Caspar was young and beardless and ruddy countenance, and it was he who bought the gift of frankincense. Belshazzar was a black man with a newly grown beard, and how would you know this? And he was bought with the gift of myrrh. From very early times, of course, we hear about these gifts, and we really know, Melchior, the old man, gray hair, long beard, about to get the gold. So let's look at these gifts a little closer. And as you look at these, it really affirms my faith for what they stand for. For these gifts tell you the entire who Jesus was and what he was going to do. So let's look at the first gift, the gift of gold. Now, gold was a gift for a king. Jesus was King of Kings and Lord of Lords. But he chose not the power to conquer nations or force people he wanted them to do. He came as the Prince of Peace, far different than the Roman Empire at the time he was there. Now, he could have done whatever he wanted to. That was another question that you two stand. Why didn't Jesus just take charge and start zapping people and say, you better behave? Again, that's what kids think. But this was not done from a throne, but from a cross. This was something that people didn't understand. You see, you have to keep in mind when you read this time period what's going on. All these years I taught in college, I always gave them, I was big into history, I taught philosophy, but I was really big into history, to say what's going on at that time. And you kind of identify with that. I like music a lot. I'm big into rock and roll, my era. And but it seems to me, if you look at what the songs are saying, what's going on in the world, you kind of know what it was like to live in the 60s. We need to know, as my professor said in seminary, Dr. Baddorf, he said one time, you got to go back in time and breathe the stinky air and let the dirt get on your sandals and get a feel for the people and what they're thinking and what's going on. And the number one thing about them was they hated the Roman Empire, for they were God's chosen. And now these people have come and taken over. So they were very, very disturbed about that. So the fact that Jesus came as a Prince of Peace, they were looking for one who would restore the nation to the glory of the time of Solomon. But that wasn't what Jesus wanted. They suffer from the same thing a lot of people do in our, even in our time. We put too much emphasis on the earthly realm. When, if you were traveling, and we just got done, and you stay in a motel, some are good. I'm supposed to fill out a survey about it. And I saw the most weird shower system ever. And they have this bar and it slides up, but it won't stay up. And unless you're this tall, you can't really use the shower. So you're trying to, so it was awful. It's just a bad situation. But it's only a couple of nights. Now, if your house had that system, you're forced to deal with it. Especially if you live in the house for 50 years. But we're only here temporary. Why do we make such a fuss about insignificant things when your life compared with eternity is but a snap of the fingers? That's it. It's over. If I said to you, if you could retire and have plenty of money, would you take pain for 60 seconds? It's going to be bad pain. You'd say, well, 60 seconds, I'll tough out anything. But we act like the earthly realm is the only one, and that's not our home. That's why I do a lot of funerals. You're going to say, I'm going home. Your brother Tony's casket said, going home. That is your home if you know Jesus as your personal Savior. And that's very important. So they wanted a king who would conquer the Romans, get rid of them, and make them top dog in the world. That wasn't why Jesus came. Mm-hmm. He came for one reason, to give us eternal life. It's interesting to note that, again, customs vary from place to place, you know. So we've established that we're going to go along with the three kings. And it was gold was what you would present to a king. So the presentation of the gold meant that Jesus, it was showing he was King of Kings and Lord of Lords. The second gift was a gift of frankincense, a gift for the priest. In temple worship, it was used in the sacrifices. A sweet perfume of frankincense was used. This was appropriate because Jesus one day would become the perfect sacrifice. For see, we had to have a perfect sacrifice. Remember back in the Jews when they would do Passover, they had to have a lamb, and they'd take this lamb, and they would stake it in front of the house, and they'd look at it. And finally, the head of the house would say, I find no fault. This lamb has no spot or blemish. That was what Jesus was. So, this frankincense. In the days of temple worship, the priest was the access to God. He went into the Holy of Holies. He was the one that prayed for the sins of the people. But notice what happened to the temple curtain when Jesus died on the cross. Remember what happened? Ripped in two. And that's very symbolic because we don't need a special place. God is just as much in your car as in this building. And that's not sacrilegious. This is a special place to us. But he's in your heart. No more need for the high priest. The word in Latin for priest is pontifex, which means bridge builder. In other words, to connect us to God. The priest was the bridge between the people of God. He was the one that offered the sacrifice. Remember that when sin entered the world through the sin of Adam and Eve, all the sins of Adam were cut off from God. The gates of heaven were closed. What the priest did was a foreshadow of what Christ would do. If you ever saw the in Sight and Sound, there's a scene in the one presentation we saw where Christ dies and he goes in and sees down and he leads the people out of this fiery place. Now it was a non-fiery and a fiery place. But he took them out of there. Up until that time, no one could enter heaven. But Jesus paid the price. He became the high priest. And so that gift of frankincense talks about being a priest. And he was the priest, the function that connected us with God the Father. The last one was myrrh, an embalming fluid. I could just see Mary say, what do you got here? Oh, I got some embalming fluid. It's really nice. What do you say? It kind of bothered you. It was the gift for one who died. Myrrh was used to embalm the bodies of the dead. You may say this was a strange gift, but like the other two gifts, it then told us what Jesus would do. Give his life for the entire world. Christ came into the world to die so that we would have eternal life. Over the years, and I go to seminary, it's an interesting place. It's a 3-year degree program. Again, I did a 4th year for education. But I'll tell you what, you get different denominations, different theologies. Boy, do we have some discussions in the lounge about what people believe in. I remember in one class, we kind of sat at tables. We had the conservative table, more liberal table over here. And different opinions. I saw a seminarian say, well, yeah, Jesus died, but he was God. He could block the pain. No, he didn't block the pain. He was fully God. When Jesus came into this world and took on the human body, he was still fully God. Fully human, fully God. But sometimes we downplay the human side. That suffering was just like anybody else. And I had a teenager say, did Jesus, if he was a carpenter, hit his finger or thumb with a hammer? And what did he yell out? How am I going to answer that question?
Ouch.
Ouch. It was a polite ouch. We're actually more stonecutters than carpenters. I wanted to get into that. But he felt everything. He stepped on a nail, he felt it. He felt pain. That body was as human as anyone in this room, but he was also fully God with a mission. And if you look in the Genesis, it already predicts the birth of Jesus, that he would come and save the world. Mm-hmm. But understand, volunteer. Now the Trinity is something that we accept on faith. I just even tell young people, if you can figure that out, so simple, you got the sermon next Sunday. But I believe it on faith. I really do. So, what happens here? Jesus, we downplay the human, but the human is very important. And to suffer on the cross, it is the worst death ever. To kind of give you an idea, don't go home and do this stuff. If I stretch my arms out and stand on my toes like this, and after a while, yeah, I can start to, I can breathe. Yeah, it's not easy to do. Oh, yeah. Stretched out and nails through here, the legs, and he suffered and suffered. But the part you talk about crucifixion, the reason I finally gave in to letting Christ come into my life was when I read the words in the middle of agonizing the human body of Jesus. He said, Father, forgive them. They know not what they do. And I realized, if I'd have been on that cross, I'd have called the 10,000 angels. I said, I had enough of this nonsense. You ungrateful people, I come here and look what you do to me, crucify me. But he never, never, never even thought about doing that. Now there is, I mean, praying to God in Gethsemane, there is, if you look at it, he says, if this cup could pass for me. Now, was he saying he didn't want to do this? Mm-mm. No, the human side thought, this is not going to be very good. I'm going to suffer. But he suffered because he loved us. My oldest son, of course, you know, I got three kids, and one's with Michael, and they've gone through times when they've been ill and different things. And how many times when they were really sick, I said, Lord, just put this sickness on me. And we all as parents know what that is. But the love we have as parents can't compare. Sometimes we get angry at our kids when we shouldn't, and sometimes we do silly things. But no time, no matter how bad it got, no time did Jesus ever even think about saying, Father, time to go back to heaven. These people are beyond help. And you know what? And it is true, like that old evangelist said one time when we were in Southwest Ohio, was that it was a rather powerful one of them yelling preachers. He said, without Jesus, you'd all burn in hell. Now that doesn't sound too exciting, too nice to say, but he was right about that. Despite the fact that people have different points of view, to me this is so encouraging. These three gifts tell me how wonderful it describes gold for the king, frankincense for the now high priest, who would be the ultimate sacrifice, and myrrh, because he would die on the cross. As we can see by looking at the scriptures, Christ was the suffering servant who would be slaughtered for the sins of the world. Jesus came into the world to usher the kingdom of God, but most of all, as you read the scripture, to truly reveal the love of God for us. Do you realize how much God loves you? It's amazing. And one day, like the lamb, he would be led to the slaughter. His final conquering act was to die on the cross, and he truly defeated Satan. Jesus came to earth to give life for all who will call upon his name. The gift of gold, frankincense, and myrrh well describes what Jesus would do. But friends, as we look at what's happening in the world today, I think we better be a little bit prepared spiritually. Because Israel and all that's happened, and there's nations that want to destroy Israel. They will not destroy Israel. Scripture says that very clearly, that when that time comes of Jesus' return, this generation will not pass away. The year I was born, 1948, is when Israel became a nation. Am I that generation? I think so. But don't fear it. We hear so much what's going on and all the horrible things, the peace and the wars. It's okay. Because when Jesus comes back now, every knee shall bow and every tongue confess. He's not coming back in secrecy. The world's going to know that who he is. And he promised to come back. And the very Bible you have, what did the last thing when he ascended? This Jesus will one day return in like manner. Yep. We may be living in the greatest time ever as Christians to see the appearance of Jesus Christ. That's pretty exciting.
It is.
You know, and we don't have to worry.
Nope.
Because he's your Savior. If he's in your heart. But boy, if you're not, that old evangelist is right. It's not popular preaching today. It's not prosperity gospel we hear so much by the big time preachers. You will end up in hell. And people say, oh, you'll offend people. Well, I'll tell you what, I'd rather offend a few people in church building than that the devil torments you in hell. And that's the fact it is. So, gold, frankincense, and myrrh. I hope you look at them a little different when you hear them. We can see that even though Jesus, just 2 years old, we have foretold that Jesus would be the true king, the perfect high priest, and the supreme sacrifice for the sins of the world. We're going to have communion here in a moment. And as you do that, on your way and you're waiting to come up, just say a little prayer to yourself and how grateful we are that we are once again be reminded of the death of Jesus Christ. It says, no greater love can one give than to lay down their life for another. And that's what Jesus Christ did. Let's turn to service award and table number 2 on page 12. Need a moment to find that. Service award and table number 2 on page 12. Christ our Lord invites to this table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin, and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another.
Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors.
Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we're yet sinners. That proves God's love towards us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Lord, we
God. The bread represents the body of Christ. The cup represents his shed blood. Our sins are covered by the saving blood of Jesus. Let us read together the great thanksgiving. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join an unending hymn.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ is high, Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here, and on these gifts of bread and vine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, till Christ comes in final victory, and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, O mighty Father, now and forever. Amen.
Amen.
This time we invite you to the Lord's table.
Thank you.
so take now and eat the bread. Remember Christ who died for you. The cup represents the saving blood of Jesus. Take now, drink the cup, and remember your sins are covered by his saving blood. Let us pray. Lord, again, we thank you for your great love for us. No greater love than one can lay down their life for another. Thank you for being our Savior. In your name we pray. Amen. Go now in the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus came to earth, fully God, fully human. The pain on the cross was unbearable, but he did it because of his love for you. Take now and eat the bread. Never forget the love of Christ for you. As you hold the cup, represents the blood of Jesus. Blood is the very life force of the body. He gave his life that we might have eternal life. Take now and drink the cup. Let us pray. Lord, again, we thank you for being our Lord and Savior. Once again, we be reminded of your death on the cross and your love for us. Bless us now, we pray in Christ's name. Amen. Go now in the peace of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Thank you. bread represents the body of Jesus Christ. Take now and eat the bread. Never forget that Jesus truly loves you. As you hold the cup represents the saving blood of Jesus. Remember, when you stand before the Lord one day on Judgment Day, your sins will be covered by the blood of Jesus. Take now and drink the cup and be ever grateful for his sacrifice. Let us pray. Lord, again, we thank you that once again we're reminded of your death on the cross of Calvary. You went through great pain and agony, but no one can ever love us as great as Jesus. Thank you for that great love as we pray in Christ's name. Amen. Go now in the peace of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ the Lord.
Amen.
Christmas hymn till next year. And we'll close with the number 245, the first Noel.
Thank you.
morning for all the blessings you bestowed upon us. But the greatest gift ever was the gift of eternal life. As we think of those three gifts, foreshadowing what you would do, what your final time on earth would be, we thank you for your great love. Now bless us, we pray, in Jesus' name, amen. God bless you and have a great day, Lord.
God the Father gave his Son, gave his own.